Good morning, everyone. Nice to see smiling masks. I mean, smiling faces, smiling eyes. We can tell, even if people are smiling by their eyes, right? Nice to see everyone's smiling eyes. Now, we don't have the candles for Advent, but, you know, we are in the Advent season. We didn't do that this year, but I thought we could at least talk about it a little bit and maybe pick a song or two related to the theme of the week. So last week was the first week of Advent, and we didn't do last week as far as the theme, but it was hope. It was typically the first week of Advent, one of the traditional first weeks. Theme is hope, and so I picked O Little Town of Bethlehem to start us off this morning to go along with the hope theme. You know, sometimes when we look at the Christmas carols, we just kind of sing the words, and we think, oh, you know, kids like to sing Christmas carols. It's fun around Christmas. But the theology in some of the Christmas hymns is fantastic. It's really, really good. And the reason I picked this is because of the line, the hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. The hopes and fears of all the years. That's true. This is our source, our living hope, our eternal hope was resting right there in Bethlehem that night, that long night ago in this tiny little town. Talk about a nothing town. That was truly a nothing town, just a little wide spot in the road, maybe a, you know, a one-stop sign town sort of thing. But it right there in that evening, the hopes of every person right there. I just think that's a great line, and so that's the reason I picked this for our theme of hope. If you could stand and join me, we'll start off this morning with O Little Town of Bethlehem. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie above. One more song before you can come up for announcements. Rodney's got a great old hymn of the faith to share. If you want to sit for a moment, sing along for sure if you know it. It isn't a hymnal, but we don't have hymnals. But if you know it, please feel free to sing along.
As I travel through this land, there is a friend who walks with me. He leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. It will be my prayer, dear Lord, this day to help me do the best I can. For I need the light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. Oh, I need the end. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy path. Hear my feeble plea. Oh Lord, look down on me. As I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Let me travel in the light divine that I may see. Keep me that I may be wholly thine and sing redemption song someday. I will be a soldier brave and true and never finally take a stand. As I onward go and daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. Oh Lord, I need every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy path. Hear my feeble plea. Oh Lord, look down on me. As I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. As I kneel in prayer, I hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Good morning, church. I think we can all agree that that was fantastic. Rodney showing off on his 53rd birthday. Now, I appreciate everything you guys do. It's always wonderful to hear how God works and moves you folks through music, and I sure enjoy it myself. I know we all do. Not a whole lot to announce this morning. I know last week I said this week would be the business meeting, but they got pushed back for a week since Sean usually conducts the meetings and could not be here. So we'll do that right after service here in the sanctuary next week. Also wanted to lift up a prayer request. A good friend of mine, Brian Robinson, he had a stroke yesterday. He's my age. You folks may have seen him here. He and Becky and their daughter Aubrey have visited the church many, many times. Not sure of his condition. I think it was a mild stroke, but he's an awful young man to be going through something like that. So I just ask that you keep Brian and Aubrey and Becky in your prayers this week. You did? Okay. Okay.
So just pray for him because he does not want to be there, she said.
Mm-hmm.
And he's not getting any rest, which, you know, you don't get a whole lot in the hospital or anything.
But, yeah. So. Okay. Well, thank you for the update. Does anybody have any prayer requests this morning or praises?
I have a prayer.
Yes, D. Thankful for your peace. All right, let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today, God. We thank you for what you do for us every day, God, the blessings we see and those that we don't. God, we know you protect us every day. We thank you for that protection and the peace that we have, knowing that you're there to protect us, God. Lord, I thank you for this church. Lord, I thank you for your word. God, I ask that you be here today. Lord, that we feel your presence. God, I just ask that you bless this service. Lord, be with Eugene as he delivers your message, God. We're thankful for him and his willingness to come and share it, God. Lord, I just ask that you be with the prayer requests that were spoken. Lord, also be with the ones that were unspoken as well, God. I just ask that you be with us throughout this week, God. God, direct us and forgive us for our many sins. It's in your Son's name I pray. Amen.
All right, we're going to sing a few more. Just a question for you. What are you certain of? I think a lot of people would have been certain of a lot of things before this whole COVID thing, and maybe they've changed their perspective on what they're certain of. We can be certain that our faith placed in God is going to be eternal. There's no break in God's faithfulness toward us. And when we place our hope and faith in him, we can just rest assured that it is in safe hands. Because the person who made the promise to us that our hope is based on is 100% faithful 100% of the time. And so the theme for this week is faith. Last week was hope. This week is faith. So I picked O Come All Ye Faithful to represent faith. So if you could stand and join me, we'll sing that together. We sang the chorus to close last service. I thought we'd sing the whole hymn this week.
O come all ye faithful, joyful. Come.
Love singing this next one. It kind of flies in the face of what everyone is feeling right now, that all is well. But the reality is, the spiritual reality is, all is well, because Christ is still on the throne, and he did come. Say all is well, but only because we can put our faith and hope and trust in you. And Lord, I just pray that you would prove yourself faithful yet again, Lord, and help us to see where you're working and to join in that work. And Lord, I just ask during this Christmas season that we would look for the least of these and reach out and help those come to know the good news that you have come, and that you are here and available to save. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, Fort Lewis Baptist Church.
Good morning.
Let's try that again. Good morning, Fort Lewis Baptist Church.
Good morning.
There we go. Now we got it. Thank you, Zach. Thank you for the rest of the group. Rodney, what an awesome job, brother. Appreciated that song. Great job there. Great job by everybody playing and singing. Want to say thank you. Larry replaced some bulbs up here, and they're nice and bright and good, and hopefully not as hot as what we had up here, right, Zach? And not roasting, but it's good to be back. It has been a week. But I was thinking this morning, I told my wife, this is one of my favorite times of the year, Christmas, is because of the simple fact this is one of the only times of the year that you can wear any tie you want with any shirt you got and ain't nobody going to complain, because it's just a Christmas time. You know, you can wear it, don't have to match. You just put your shirt on and reach in the closet and pull out something and stick it on, and it works. And I've got several Christmas ties. I've got one that I started to wear this morning that it's got three little men on it, and you would think they would be singing something or whatever, but it says, one of them says, "Yes, dear." The other one says, "Okay, honey." And the other one says something about whatever you say. So You know, it pretty well fits in most cases. It has been a week for us. Last Thursday, the computer crashed. I thought it was going to be something simple. Take it to the shop on Monday, give it to them. About 2 days, they'd have my computer fixed, and we just go on with life. After 5 days in the shop and them running multiple programs, we come to find out we lost everything. I know on one file alone, because we were able to have it, on one file alone there was over 17,000 items that we lost. Sermons from all the way back from, oh man, who knows. I know there was stuff on there from 2011 and 12 and stuff that we lost, pictures by the thousands that we had lost, and none of that can be recovered that I know of. They run every program they could. They tried, bless their heart. They give it a valiant effort, but we just seem to have lost it. So that has made it tough, because all week I was without my computer, trying to do my studying, you know, with all my cell phone, and you know how that goes. You're looking at a little screen, trying to do your studying and get your thoughts together. Couldn't really put much down on paper, except just what was in my head. And so I was typing notes into my notes section on my phone. And it was just, you know, it was one of them things. But you know what? We made it through. And as the song we just sang, all is well. It's okay. It's after the way 2020's been, maybe it was meant for me just to lose all of 2020. And, you know, because that's basically what I lost. We had everything else backed up. We lost everything. Well, I shouldn't say we had everything else backed up. None of the pictures, I don't think, were backed up. But the notes from a year ago or so were, but especially everything ministry related in the past year is gone. And that's the way it is. Can't get it back. But anyway, I do thank each one of you for being here today. Thank you for the love and kindness you've shown to us. Thank you for the support that you've given. And thank you most of all for continuing to support your church. It's not about us as individuals. It's about who we serve. And when we come into this building on any given Sunday, we should not be coming to church just to see who is here or to see what someone is wearing or to be able to speak or talk to a certain person just to be able to have fellowship. We need to be coming because we want to come and worship the Lord. And so thank you, church, for being here and wanting to do those things. Thank you for continuing to support your church and the ministries of it. If I was to ask you this morning, I want you to be taking your Bibles, turn to Isaiah. Isaiah chapter number 9. I'm going to use one verse this morning. One verse and one verse only out of this chapter. Isaiah chapter number 9. But if I was to ask you this morning while you're finding it, we've got the nativity scene in front of us, and I love this nice big nativity scene. But if I was to ask you today in our society, who is the most important person in society today? Some folks would have various answers. Some people would say, well, the rulers of our nation, the leadership of our nation is most important. Other people, like my children, oftentimes I've heard my children say it, and you get these cards every year at Father's Day or at Mother's Day, Dad, you are the greatest. I like that. I like that when they tell me that. I know it ain't the truth, but I like it anyway, okay? But when we ask who's the most important, if you ask that question in the church, who's the most important person in the church or the most important committee or the most important set of people, people would have a varying opinion on that. Well, it's the leadership team or it's the music team. And you know what? The truth of the matter is no one person is more important than the other. But there was one that is spoken about in the scriptures that we are told is the most important person to ever be recorded in history. Now, some of the world does not look at it this way, and some of the world looks at Christ in a little different manner. But I want to read to you out of Isaiah chapter number 9 and verse number 6 this morning. Isaiah chapter number 9 and verse number 6 says this, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now listen, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful. His name shall be called Counselor. His name shall be called the Mighty God. His name shall be called the Everlasting Father. His name shall be called the Prince of Peace. Let's pray. Father, thank you today for this opportunity to come once again and to share here with this wonderful congregation, with this great group of people. And Father, today as you open our eyes to the scriptures, as we read the texts that uplift your name, may you remove us from the sight. May you hide us behind this pulpit today. May you use the words that we say, nothing more, nothing less, to touch hearts and to touch lives. And may each one that hears the word today be able to leave this building encouraged in their walk with you, encouraged in their relationship with your Son and our Savior, Jesus Christ. And Father, as we go into this world, may we be able to point others to that saving grace knowledge also. Father, as we've sang the songs today and as we've heard the sentiment repeated over and over, we thank you that your Son truly is God with us. We love you today. We give you the praise for it. For we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Quite a list for a person, isn't it? To be called all of these things. To be called Wonderful. I'm sure everyone in here would like, at some point in your life, for people to look at you and say, you know what, that person is wonderful. I think about these things. Wouldn't it be great to be called the greatest counselor ever? You know, I've told more than one woman on occasion, my wife is an incredible counselor. She does a great job when it comes to ministering to females, to young ladies, to even to children. She's a great counselor, but she's not the greatest ever. She's not the greatest person to ever give advice or to share testimony. I think about some people in our society and how we watch them rise to the top, and we look at their lives and we think, wow, that person is important in our nation, in our society, in our community. We see leaders rise up and take a stand, and we see people crumble and fall. But we look at all of these and we think that person is important until we look at them in comparison to what this verse we read today is. When we look at ourselves, and that's what I want you to challenge you to do today, I want to challenge you to look at yourself in light of this verse and understand who this verse is about. This verse is about and prophecy about the coming Messiah, Christ himself. And so when we read this verse today, we read, unto us a child is born. That's what this nativity scene you see in front of you is about. That's what this season we are celebrating is about. It is about the birth of Jesus Christ. Now, you know, across our nation, I think I said this last year, across our nation, there could be discussion. Some people don't believe this is the right time of year to celebrate. Some people, and I can concur with this kind of, that possibly it should be more dated towards the springtime of the year because of where the shepherds were when all this took place and everything. But that's not what Christmas is about. Christmas isn't necessarily about what time of year it is. Christmas is about a person. It's about Christ coming to earth in the form of a small child, in the form of a small baby, being born of a virgin, conceived through the Holy Spirit, and coming to this earth. Why? To die for you and I. Now that's hard to fathom when we think someone is born to die. Each one of us were born, and immediately upon being born, we started the dying process. And as we live through life, we slowly deteriorate, and our bodies deteriorate, and everything about us deteriorates. And one day, you and I, if not called forth before then, if not taken out of here, we will eventually go to the grave too. I've had the, I don't know if you call it pleasure, or doubt that I would call it pleasure, but I've had the opportunity far more than I ever wanted to put friends and relatives and church folks, folks I didn't even know, to stand at the graveside and say words over them, to stand in the funeral home and to preach the last message that will be spoken about them. I've had the distinct opportunity to put far more people into the grave than I ever would have loved to have seen. I used to tell folks I really didn't mind doing funerals, and people thought that was kind of morbid, but I had to compare it. I didn't mind doing funerals in comparison to weddings. And the reason why, and I used to make a joke, they were one and the same, but I won't make that joke here today. Zach looked over. Be careful out there. I used to say that you could do a funeral, and if you messed up, said the wrong thing, something didn't go right, a few days people would have forgotten it was gone. You mess up somebody's wedding. You mess up somebody's wedding, it is going down in history. Matter of fact, oftentimes you see the clips. How often, let me ask you this, I know I'm getting totally off track here. How often on America's Funniest Videos do you ever see a funny video about somebody messing up a funeral? But how often on America's Funniest Videos do you see a preacher or something happen in a wedding? Because it's recorded for history. But we read about in the scripture a child that was born to die. I got to thinking about the Christmas account, and what we know. Chapter 2 of Luke, and I'm not going to go there and read, but chapter 2 of Luke is the Christmas story kind of outline for us. Joseph and Mary go to Bethlehem to be taxed, or he takes her, goes to, I got my words off. They go to be taxed, okay? And while they're there, the days come that she's supposed to deliver the baby, so they hunt out a place, and they couldn't find a place in the inn, so they go out and they find a place. Some folks say, the King James uses the word manger, some people say in a stable, wherever you want to put them. They find a place, and the baby is born. Angels announce the birth of the baby to the shepherds. The shepherds come to see this newborn child, and all of these things. And I got to thinking in my head, I wonder if we took into consideration everyone's role in the Christmas story, who would be the most important? And as I began to read Luke chapter number 2 again this week, it got in my mind, well, the first person you could say was important was Caesar Augustus. You say, how is he important? He's the one that caused all this mess and sending people where they needed to be. They would have been at home if they hadn't had to go. Well, Caesar Augustus was the emperor in ancient Rome at that time, and he gave the decree for everyone to be taxed. So we could say that in the Christmas story, Caesar Augustus was one of the most important, because prophecy dictated that Jesus would be born in a certain place. He would be wrapped in a certain type of clothes. He was going to be lowly, meek, and humble. He wasn't going to be some great king. So Caesar Augustus' decree sent Mary and Joseph there. So we could say, well, Caesar Augustus is one of the most important people in the text. We could look next at Joseph. We could say to ourselves, well, Joseph surely is the most important person in the Christmas account. Why would Joseph be the most important? Well, he was an upright man who knew beyond a shadow of doubt he had never had relations with Mary. He never had a question about that. He knew that she was pure and she was upright, and he himself was a just man. But yet he was willing to take the criticism of his society, the people that stood around and mocked and probably said things about her and said things about him. He was willing to take all that on his shoulder, be the man that God had called him to be, and says, you know what, I'm going to take her as my wife anyway. Contrary to what anybody says, I'm going to make her look good in the sight of folks, and I'm going to take her upon my shoulders as my responsibility. And he become known for all eternity as the earthly father of Jesus. An important role, no doubt. An important role. Because had he have not followed the decree of Caesar Augustus, and done what he was asked to do or done what he was commanded to do, they would not have been where they were when the birth took place. So we could look at him as important. How about Mary herself? Mary herself, the young virgin girl, pure, innocent, spoken to by God, told you are going to conceive a child in your body, even though you've never been with a man, you're going to conceive a child, and he will be born into this world to save the world from their sin. And yet she was troubled and frightened and scared. Now, if I had to put it in an order here, I would say of all I've talked about, Mary probably is the most important. In some religions, in some backgrounds, I guess I should say, Mary is thought of as highly or looked at with the same or very similar appreciation as Jesus himself is. Mary was an important role and did play an important role because she would go on to be known as the mother of Christ. Joseph is known as the father, even though he truly wasn't. Mary is known as the mother of Christ, and she truly was, and yet had never been with a man. And so we look at Mary and we think, wow. Why would God choose this little insignificant girl in this little insignificant city to use to bring forth the Christ? You and I both know, if we've studied the Bible anyway, it was because of the lineage and the heritage that would flow through that bloodline and through the lineage of the families is the reason that she was chosen. But could we not say that she gave birth? She was the most important one. Because if it wasn't for her giving birth, Jesus would have never been born. Or at least not through this bloodline. And so we would not have the Christmas story. So certainly she's got to be the greatest, right? Or one of the most important. What about the innkeeper? The innkeeper, when they rolled into town that night, they were looking for a place to stay. Is that correct terminology? They rolled into town. Well, technically, I guess they rode into town. Yeah, they rode into town. But when they got to town that evening and the day's worth for her to be delivered, the scripture says they went and they asked the innkeeper, hey, can we have a room here? And the innkeeper said, there's no room for you in the inn. Now, I want you to think about that. This is an individual in most Christmas accounts and in most speaking of the nativity scene that gets left out. But had this innkeeper have allowed them to stay in the inn, once again, I challenge that prophecy could not have been fulfilled. Had he have said, sure, we got an extra room for you, come on in. Go up there to the fourth floor, go to room six, and there's a bed and a room there. Prophecy would not have been fulfilled, as spoken of in other parts of the text. He refused service, and he forced history towards a prophesied outcome. So could we not challenge that the innkeeper is one of the most important in history? How about the shepherds? The shepherds were the first folks notified. As the shepherds set out in the field and they were tending to their flocks, the angel of the Lord comes and comes upon them and says, hey, look, over there in this little town is this small child and he's been born. You'll find him there, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. All the announcements that the angel of the Lord made. And these shepherds got up and they said, let's go see this newborn child. And so they made their way in and they saw the child. And what does Scripture tell us next over in the book of Luke? Once they had visited and seen the child, they began to broadcast. Well, actually, before they visited, they began to broadcast. But once they had seen the baby, the word spread. How did the word get spread about the newborn Christ? Through these shepherds. These shepherds begin to proclaim that Jesus had been born in Bethlehem. So could we not say that the shepherds are the most important? They were the ones that followed through and saw the new baby. They were the ones that spread the news that Christ had been born. They were the ones that proclaimed the Savior's birth. So they legitimately could claim a right to the most important in the nativity scene. What about the heavenly host? The heavenly host are the angels that came and they began to sing and they proclaimed and sang about the greatness of the new child that was born. And over in the book of Luke, we see that after the shepherds go and the angels descend and begin to praise God and sing glory to God in the highest, peace on earth. Now I got that. Peace on earth, goodwill towards men. See, I got to talking too fast. But the angels sang forth the praises of the new baby that was born. Could we not say that they possibly were the most important? So let's back up here again. We have Caesar Augustus, the Roman emperor. We have Joseph. We have Mary. We have the innkeeper. We have the shepherds. We have the heavenly host. Oh, we don't want to be impartial and forget those few wise men that come along a little bit after. Now, if you read the account, it's possible that Jesus was already of some age, but we always include that with the Christmas story, don't we? How they come along bearing their gifts. So we want to include them. Were they not the first to come and bow down? Or, well, I guess the shepherds maybe fit this too, but were they not the first to come and offer up what they had to the small child and give of themselves? It's possible. As important as all of those folks are, I think you and I understand that no one in the Christmas story is important as the smallest one. That small little tiny baby, born in poverty, no good clothes, not robed in crowns and jewels, not sleeping in a palace crib, but there in a lowly manger, wrapped in basically filthy rags, laid a small, tiny infant. In comparison to the great Roman emperor, did not look important, did not seem important, was very insignificant in the picture. In view of the father that had taken on this mother and this child to be his own, did not seem very important. In light of the mother that had born this child into the world and without her ability to do so, seemed so unimportant. And yet there, in view for us, is the most important individual to ever be born into this world. And somehow you and I, somehow society minimalizes that. The church, we speak of Jesus. The church, we talk about him 365 days a year. We speak of the goodness of God and the great mercies that God bestowed upon us by sending his son. We talk about how Jesus went to the cross of Calvary, shed his blood and died, rose victoriously. But we have to remember where it all started. And it didn't start on a cross. It didn't start in a grave. It didn't start with the stone rolled away. It started in Bethlehem. It started with a man and a woman who seemed insignificant to the rest of the world. And they had a child. And they did the best they could. They raised that child, trusting in God, depending on God. And that small child would go on to be the most important person in history. Oh, we look back at history now, and I'm not a big historian, but I can think of a few names that made an impact in history. But none ever as great as the name of Jesus. No name has ever had the impact. No name has ever changed hearts. No name has ever crumbled folks to their knees. And no name has ever lifted the most troubled up. I used part of that in a message a while back. But the truth of the matter is, and what I wanted you to see today, as important as every one of these folks are in the Christmas story, Jesus is number one. I think I used this phrase, and every one of us have heard it. I used this phrase last week, Jesus is the reason for the season. We've actually commercialized that phrase now. Now it's on signs and it's on billboards and everywhere you look. And every time I see it, it actually somewhat hurts my heart. Not because I know that it's not the truth, it is the truth. But it's become so commercialized now. Do people really look at Jesus as the reason for the season? Well, I got to go back and answer my own question I asked you to begin with. Who's the most important in the Christmas story? The truth is that even though Jesus is the focus, if I walk down here to this nativity scene, and I'm not going to do it because it's too well done, but if I walk down there and take Jesus out of the crib and I stick him in my pocket and I take him away from here with me today, does it change the story? Well, technically it does, because if he's not in that, if he wasn't born, we would have no hope. But at the same time, what if I walk down here and take Mary out of the nativity scene and I stick her in my pocket and I take her with me? Is the story the same? No. Or Joseph? Or the shepherds? What is my point here? The truth is yes, Jesus is the most important, and he is the focus of our text today. But every single one of these individuals that I've shared with you today, every single one of them play their part in the Christmas story. They all have a role in the knowledge that you and I have of who Jesus is, what he done, why he done it, how he done it. They all have a role. Do I believe that if it hadn't have been for Mary, God could have still put Jesus here? Absolutely he could have. He would have found someone else or a different way of doing it. I know that. But she does have her role in history. If Caesar Augustus hadn't have made the decree, would they have gone where they were to have the baby? Probably not. So he has his role in history. My point is here, is every single one of these play a role in the Christmas account. You say, well, what does that have to do with anything? I want you to know how I started this message is not intentionally how I meant it to be, but do you know that every single one of you have a role in the Christmas story too? You say, wait a minute, I'm not having the baby. I'm not no shepherd. I definitely ain't no wise man. I'm not Mary or Joseph. I'm not a ruler. How could I possibly have a part? If you and I had a part in the Christmas story, we would probably technically be the most like the shepherds. Remember what the shepherds done? The angel Lord came and proclaimed that the Christ had been born, and so the shepherds gathered up their stuff, and they went to see this small baby. And as they went, they began to proclaim what they had heard. And once they saw, they went out and they proclaimed what they had seen. Church, that is an exact picture of what you and I are supposed to be doing. We have the knowledge of the true account of Christmas. We have an understanding of why the Christmas account even took place. And most of us have the ability to understand the purpose in why this all was necessary. And yet for some reason we are scared to death to share it with others. Can I tell you today, for your church, but more so for Christ himself, you have a part to play in the Christmas story. You have a part to play in folks coming to know Christ, in folks putting their faith and trust in the same Savior that you believe in. You have a part Maybe not the role that these folks played, but you have a part. And it's important that you and I understand that our part, maybe not like theirs and in the same concept of what they did, but our part is important also. I look around. I heard this week, I heard of three more. Wasn't it three, Tracy? Three more churches that pastors have said, you know what? I'm done. I'm done. I'm leaving. Find somebody else. Here's my notice. I'm gone. Pastors are stepping down. Pastors are resigning their positions. Pastors are leaving for various reasons, but if not, in some cases, simply because they can't handle the pressure anymore of trying to proclaim the gospel in the day in which we are living. It's tough. It's tough to go out here and tell people, look how good God is to me. And they look around them and see what's happening and think to themselves, man, this is God being good? I understand that. But you and I have a part in the body of believers. You and I have a part in telling others about Christ. You and I have an important role, maybe not in the Christmas account, but in the conveying of the Christmas story. Do you know some of you will have the opportunity? Some of you will have the opportunity over the next few weeks to share the Christmas story with children, with other adults, with family, with friends. Are you going to take it? Are you going to tell others why the baby had to be born? Are you going to tell others more than just, well, Santa's coming? What was that I put on that thing the other day? I talked to Santa about you, and I don't remember something about how naughty you were. You ain't getting nothing for Christmas. But it's more than that. It's telling others about Christ. It's sharing the gospel message. It's being a witness and a testimony. We are going to, and at Christmas season is the best time of the year. Christmas and Easter. That's also when preachers like Christmas and Easter best, because that's when the most people come to church. Most people come to church at Christmas and Easter when they won't come any other time. But when you have the opportunity to share the love God had for His people. I'm going to close with this. Zach and them make their way back up. Just think of it this way, if nothing else. Somebody says, well, I don't understand. What's all this Christmas about? You can simply look at someone and say, you know what? Let me use myself. Eugene Mills was a sinner. I could do nothing to save myself. I couldn't earn enough or work enough or buy enough. I couldn't make enough to buy my way out. So I needed someone to take my place. And so God looked out of heaven and He saw my need and He said, you know what? I'm going to send my son to die for him. I know he's not really worth it, but he is to me. I look around this room and I see a bunch of people that really weren't worth it. But God looked down and He said, they are to me. If you and I have such a precious gift, as Christmas has become a lot about gifts, we have the greatest gift ever given, and we refuse to give it away. I'm going to go buy my kids a few Christmas presents and my grandkids. If I buy my granddaughter or my grandson, if I buy them a Christmas present, and I wrap it up, and I put it on the shelf, but I never give it to them. Is it truly a gift that's been given? Or is it just sitting there? God give us his son. And he said, now here, I'm going to give this to you, but I want you to do something with it. I want you to share the gift. Don't just keep it for yourself. Give it away again and again and again and again. I promise you, every time you give your gift away, it'll still be there for you too. He doesn't go anywhere in the heart. We retain him within our hearts and in our minds. But he asks us to give it away again also. Who are you going to share Jesus with this year? The remainder of this season? Do you have someone that you can share the greatest gift ever with? You can use the nativity scene. You can use the people of it. You can use the examples I did about who's the greatest. But I think every one of us would agree today. If I ask the question straight and simple, who's the most important? Jesus is.
Close the day with God Evermore. If you can stand and join us.
Light of eternity, Ancient of Days, glorious in holiness, worthy of praise, Wonderful Counselor, we will adore. Oh,
be in this place and what you call me to be with your children today. Father, I thank you for each one that's here. If there be one among us today that's lost and undone without Christ, may this be the day that they turn their hearts and their lives over to you. May this be the day that they bow their head and